are saluting him, because his own works were evil and his brother's righteous. He said, why did he do it? And he says, when? Because his own works were evil and his brother's were righteous. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death into life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoso hath this world's good, and seeth his brother have need, and sheddeth up his vows compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. A couple of years ago, Sherwood Baptist Church in Albany, Georgia made a movie that we actually showed here at the church called Fireproof. The premise of the movie is you've got a firefighter who's watching his marriage fall apart before his eyes, and his father steps in and encourages him to wait 40 days before taking any action. You probably remember the movie. But during that time, he's going through a book that's called The Love Deck, which consists of 40 daily lessons from Scripture and a challenge on how he would show his wife how he loved her. The end result was after 40 days, his marriage wasn't fixed. But he continued with it. He continued with the love there until he finally reached out to his wife and won his wife back. Not only that, she wanted whatever it was that caused the change in his life, and that was a relationship with Jesus. That's the power of love, especially a love that's loud. A love that's loud. Then here's the question, do we love loud? When I say love loud, I mean having a love that's not one you simply talk about, but one that's evident because it's both seen and heard. Not just heard, but also seen. Sadly, when we are loud, it usually isn't about love, is it? I mean, some of you were loud the other day when OSU, you know, won a football game. Reason because it's so uncommon. But you and some the other a few days before that were loud because of the Sooners. You know, she asked them what they had. Sandy texted me about midway through the game and says, I hate OU. The OU fans are like that. You know, fire Bob Stoops, you know, because he lost the game. But the truth of the matter is, that's the way a lot of our love is. We're loud about moral standards that we hold dear, and rightly so. We're loud in our disagreements. Even if the lost are witnessing it, we're loud. We're loud when we assume we're right, even when we might be wrong. But are we loud in our love? Are we loud? We're going to look at 1 John 3, and I'm challenging our church this year to love loud. I believe it's going to be a pivotal year here in our church. If we as a church can learn to love loud, and I want you to listen this morning, I'm simply going to call this sermon, Love Loud. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, I pray right now that you would help us to receive the challenge. That it would be a personal challenge and also a corporate challenge for our entire church. That we would purpose in our heart that this year, we're not only going to talk this Christianity stuff, but we're going to live it out. We're going to love that. and God, we're going to show it the way Jesus did it. We'll talk about that later. Dear God, I pray that you'll speak to our heart. I pray you'll talk to people on the inside while I talk to them on the outside. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. What would it be like if our congregation were to make this our personal challenge that we're going to love back? What would God do if we dared to love loudly? What would our community see if we put the love of Christ in action? I want to challenge you this morning in that very arena. There's four truths about loving loudly I want to talk about today. The first truth is found in verse 11. For this is the message that you heard from the beginning, that you should love one another. The first point is love is not an option. It's not an option. If you're a born-again believer this morning, you have no option but to love others. Why? Because it was Jesus himself that said, you must love. This is the message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Now listen to the exact words in John chapter 13, verse 34. He said, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have loved one toward another. If you love one another. Well then, go to John chapter 15, verse 12. And this is my commandment. Here's Jesus talking. Jesus in his own words talking very personally. He said, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if you do whatsoever I command you. Man, that's a God, not verse 14. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, and ordained you, that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. These things I command you, that you love one another. I don't have time to develop all of what's in this passage here, but do you see the application if we do what Jesus said to do? Do you see the promise there that he said? He said, if you'll get this down, if you get this one thing down in your life, he said, then he said, you'll be able to go to the Father, and he'll do whatever he asks you to do. If you get this deal down about loving God and about loving people, then you see what we have at our disposal. I mean, Jesus, but see, that's a new message. It's something that's going to happen better players. I mean, do you see what Jesus said? He said, here's what you can have. God controls the universe. God is omnipotent. God has all power. He said, but if you get this one thing down to love me and to love others, he says, here, you can have the very God of heaven. Ask him anything and he'll do. I mean, it's right there. It's right there in the Holy Spirit. You don't need no prayer than what it is right there. That applies to our church. Then if our church would just get this. And by the way, we have it yet. We have it yet. Now, by the way, it's a commandment. It's not a suggestion. It isn't even a recommendation. He said, do it. He said, you've got to do this. And it's also one of these commandments that we find not only repeated, but repeated often in the Scripture. And that we should, that ought to tell us, and in fact, one of the few commandments that we find more often in Scripture than this love thing is singing your praise to the Lord. All throughout the Bible, that phrase is used more Old Testament, New Testament, that singing your praise to the Lord. I don't have time to go into all that either. But then again, that may be the issue. We put so many restrictions on what we like or prefer and allow our culture preferences to dominate our worship. I just said a mouthful of that, but it's so true. We put so many restrictions on what we like or prefer and allow our cultural preferences to dominate our worship. We have a hard time singing our praise unto the Lord. I mean,
vision that Christians there. He said, here's what you need to do. Make a melody in your heart. Singing praises unto the Lord in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs. Make a melody in your heart. Pass it to the Lord, he said. We're singing the Lord. We seem to have a hard time doing that. And if we can't do something as simple as singing, no wonder we struggle with loving. We struggle with it. Yet that doesn't excuse from the fact that God has called us and commanded us to love. First of all, love Him. That's the first stretch of that. The lawyers one day will argue. They couldn't even come to trip Him up. What's the biggest commandment? What's the greatest commandment of all the Bible? And Jesus is, He says, you need to love the Lord your God with everything you have. Love the Lord. Love Him. That's the first and greatest commandment. And we all know that. He said, love God. And then secondly, he says the second is likened to it, to love our neighbor as ourselves. Well, who is our neighbor? Well, it depends on where you are, I guess, and the way we use it. And by the way, Jesus explained that later. But at home, first of all, at home, your neighbor would be your family. I mean, how do you love Jesus? I mean, you get what John said, we'll get into this later. But you know what John said? He says, how can you say you love God? Well, you can't see. When you can't even love your brother, who you can't see? That starts in our heart. Don't tell me you love God if you don't love your wife. Don't tell me you love God if you don't love your kids. Don't tell me you love God if you don't love your husband. You don't even, hey, you know. That dog just will not. Here's how you know. And by the way, Jesus addressed this. He said, here's the way that men